Hi, I'm Mike North. I'm a principal staff engineer and product architect at Stripe, and I've been a front-end master's instructor for 10 years. It's always been important to deeply understand a domain and to collaborate with teams, but now with the rise of AI-assisted coding tools, it's more important than ever. In this course, we'll build a full-stack app while designing data models, finding encapsulation opportunities, making smart data consistency decisions, and keeping our most important core logic clean. Go have engaging conversations with users, product managers, and AI agents, and bring those insights into stronger software design. Let's jump into our project and start implementing this. So where we're going to start is in the types folder. We're going to go into, I'm going to close server for now, and we're in packages, types, source, and we've got a folder here called entities, and we've got a folder here called value objects. So I think we have a temperature value object to implement here, and let's start there. I'm going to create a new file. Let me close some of this stuff, which we'll pull up later. You can leave those tabs open because those are files we're going to need to touch. Temperature. And I'm just going to follow the convention here because, you know, we're going to have another temperature TS that exists elsewhere. Temperature.type.ts. And let's start with like copying and pasting some code from an existing value object. So we've got a temperature type here. I'm going to start by grabbing this distance type because it's kind of got some interesting stuff in it. And I just want to get a nice little starting point. I'll just grab this because a lot of these will end up looking the same. So we're importing Zod, this library for defining schemas. And we're going to want a temperature unit schema. And let's just focus on Celsius and Fahrenheit, just C and F. And this is kind of our source of truth for what it means to be a temperature unit, but this isn't a TypeScript type. Not gonna risk spelling that. And you can see like, temperature unit schema refers to a value, but I'm trying to use it as a type. So how do we get the type out of this? Z infer. Just like this. So we've got a temperature unit, and look at this down here. This is what we want. So this lets you define a Zod schema and extract the TypeScript type that matches it. Why is this so important? This ensures that your compile time type checking and your runtime validation of objects that sort of flow through this schema are very well aligned. It's useful to have a source of truth where like both things originate from the same structure. And we'll export this as a symbol so other parts of our code base can use it. Yes, question from online.
Why are we adding validation logic inside the type.ts file?
That's a good question. Maybe I should have called this like common or core. If you look at other modules in this file, it's kind of like, this is kind of a module that contains the structures of the data that we'll be working with. But this does not include just like pure type information. There are some some type guards here. Like this is checking to see if something is a valid distance unit, and we may have similar things. So perhaps a poor name of the package on my part, but this is, you can think of this as like conceptually representing the shapes of the value objects, the shapes of the entities, the shapes of the request and response shapes, like the HTTP request response shape pairs. But like, we have a schema here that's not just pure type information, and we may have type guards that make sense to sort of put, you know, in the closest place we can put them, you know, with the objects that they relate to, the shapes they relate to. So we've exported the schema because that's going to be useful for whoever's using this to do runtime validations. We'll export the type, but this is just the C and the F, right? It's just the unit. So we're going to need, just to prove that this works, like now temperature unit, like the only error we're getting is this is an unused variable. So this is the type that we can kind of carry forward in our code. In this next part of the course, we're going to focus on solving the problem of a disorganized collection of seeds and get back into the mode of domain modeling and interviewing a domain expert or collaborating with a domain expert or an LLM to figure out, like, what is the most productive direction we could go for solving this problem for our user. Before we get into this, though, let's talk a little bit about some tips for having conversations with domain experts, and then we're going to have a conversation. So first, it's very important to develop a shared vocabulary with all of the people you're collaborating on discussing a problem space with. What this helps, what this makes sure that is avoided is like things that end up being lost in translation. And you want to make sure that you have an opportunity or you give less technical people an opportunity to correct misconceptions you have. So if you're talking to your gardener about your plans to like help organize their seed catalog, and you say, well, like what we can do here is we can take these objects and we can put them into an Elasticsearch collection, and we'll have like different dimensions that we can use to search them, put some denormalized data into Elasticsearch. Like you've already lost them, and it's not that difficult to sort of take the names of classes and the names of variables and tie them to this common language that you share with your subject matter experts. When you're working with agentic coding tools, this also helps make sure that you're encoding more of the business problem right into the source code of your app. And so you can have conversations that are much more in line with, like, tell me about this seed packet. Like, do we have an estimated weight for the seed packet? And it's going to be able to go and find some terminology that joins the words used in the problem space with the words that are used in the solution to the problem. So tips for kind of having discussions that are conducive towards developing a shared language. You want to understand terminology that's being used. Ask clarifying questions. Make sure you really pin these things down and take the time as these words are mentioned for the first time or the second time, like coming up with a nice glossary of like, what do we mean when we say this is very well worth it. Use visual tools like this little diagram tool that I've been using, which is called Whimsical. You could use a whiteboard, you could use a notebook, whatever you want to use. Slides are great for diagrams. This helps make visual concepts more tangible, and try to avoid technical logic and technical terminology, such as referring to like database indices or instances of classes. Like you want to see if you can articulate kind of the shape of how you're thinking about the problem in solution agnostic terms. Tip number two, stay curious and open. So there's a failure mode for these conversations, which, well-intentioned people that want to collaborate can fall into. So if you're talking to a gardener and you listen to them say a few things, and then immediately you propose, you're like, here's how I think we could solve it, and then you sort of blurt something out, what's going to happen is the gardener's going to listen to this, and they will pattern match against it, and they'll assume, like, you're a software engineer, you're probably pretty smart, the words you're saying mostly make sense to me, but sometimes you get into this trap where they'll kind of, like, accept that description of a solution at a point in the conversation where you haven't reached alignment, where you haven't gotten to the point where you can both say, yes, the way we're thinking about this is the same, and we've actually explored all of the details, right? Like, in this case, all right, I can give you a list of your seed packets, and you can use, like, Command F, and you can find basil. Great. I guess I can find all of the basils. I can sort of advance. If I have, like, Thai basil, and sweet Genovese Basil and all of this. Like, I guess I could control F and, all right, that's fine. But like, what if there's incremental data loading and everything's not on the same page or something like that? Like, you've offered a solution where sometimes people accept it without knowing that there will be inherent limitations to what they're sort of validating to. So here we have a bunch of our plants categorized a little bit differently. We can see some of the data is threaded through. There's a lot of placeholder data that we could add to if we wanted to. And you can grab these tiles and you can drag them into the raised beds and place them. And what you may notice is that some types of actions are not allowed. For example, we see placement is out of bounds. Like if we try to put this tomato here, we can see we get a validation failure. Not just an error message, but like this is a completion of a validation task of some sort. Similarly, I think this bed, doesn't have enough sunlight for tomatoes. So I want to show you how we've set up some business validation rules. This is sort of the constraint part of how we think about these bounded contexts, right? We've got our entities, we've got our value objects, the relationships, and the important constraints. And so in this branch, what you're going to want to take a look at is something called the workspace controller. And this is ultimately where kind of like the brains of plant placement in the garden beds happen. And so if you want to look at like what kinds of things we have in here, we've got like validate item move, validate item removal, validate item placement. And these are sort of like, this is the interface that the rest of the app engages with as it relates to this workspace controller class. Now, looking near the bottom of this class, you'll see something that's interesting, and that is plant validation rules. And so here we've got something called check boundaries, right? And if we look, we've got like the target zone. Remember in the UI, we're thinking about workspace zone item. And we've got the plant item. And we're first getting the planting distance in feet or the number. And I would argue here we could change this even to size because our plant, you know, has a size on it. This is where we were doing that. You know, we have a normalized version of size that uses math.seal to like round the planting distance up to the nearest whole foot, make sure we're at least at one cell by one cell. And then we really just look at kind of the lower left corner of where the plant tile is, and that's the target X and Y. So in the case of this tomato plant, like you see the little coordinate system on the left and the bottom of the raised beds. So all we have to do is say like this bottom left cell of the four cells it would occupy, if we take that coordinate and walk upwards and we exceed the height of the bed, or if we walk rightwards and we exceed the width of the bed, this is out of bounds. And that's this logic here. Target X, target Y plus size. So if we were to make this more interesting and maybe these tiles aren't squares, this is where we would go and change that. Now, what we do here is, this is kind of the concept of returning an error rather than throwing an error. So a lot of programming languages, like Golang is a good example that follows this, returning errors as values. And there's something very important about articulating things this way in this case. There's a difference between I threw while attempting to perform a validation versus I successfully performed a validation and it failed. So this in and of itself is an important part of how you might model a validation task. There's like, I completed and this is allowed, or I completed but this is disallowed. And then there's like, I exploded, or you attempted to place me in a garden bed that, as far as I know, doesn't exist. So a good mental model I use here, because we already have to deal with this, HTTP requests, right? There's like a difference between an HTTP request that's like, am I allowed to place this here? Like, would you ever say you're going to say like a 400 bad request if it's sort of like not enough sunlight for the plant? You want to say, yes, we successfully completed the validation operation, respond 200. And the answer is no, you can't place the plant there.